Hello everyone, today we are going to start with chapter number 7 of history 9th ICSC, which is the medieval India, the Cholas. So this was from the southern part of the India peninsula, situated south to the Krishna river, was inhabited by the Dravidians. Okay, so they had their own language and culture. This region has become of three powerful kingdoms, which are the Chera, Pandyas and the Cholas. The most powerful of the three were the Cholas. The Chola Empire, which arose from the 9th century, brought under the control of a large part of the peninsula. The Cholas developed a powerful navy, which enabled them to develop India's sea trade and Indian Ocean, and to conquer Sri Lanka and Maldives Islands by the end of the 19th century. The Cholas defeated the Pallavas of Kanchi and weakened the Pandyas, bringing the Tamil country, which was Tonvadandala, under their control. The sources are the inscriptions which were written, and the main sources of the information of the history of the Chola period is a large amount of inscription of the period. Rajaraja I convinced the idea of prefixing to his inscriptions and the main achievements of his region. The example of the Rajaraja was followed by his successor as well. Consequently, there exists a formal record of the transactions made by their Chola ruler. And the inscriptions of the Cholas are in the form of copper plate grants, stone inscriptions and inscriptions made on the wall and the pillars of the temples. The copper plate grants known as the Anbil and Karandi, as well as the Kanyakumari stone inscription given a long list of rulers indicating the origin of the Chola dynasty. Another set of the copper plate contains 31 copper sheets. These plates are written in the Sanskrit and Tamil. They record the grant made to a temple by Rajendra Chola I. So these inscriptions provide the following information of the Chola, they tell us about the Chola administration. For example, the Uttarameru inscription gives the information on the village administration, taxation and revenue. Then we have the record gifts of endowments to temples and Brahmins. Copper plates inscriptions are the records of the grant of villages, plots of lands and other privileges to the individual. Then we have they also inform us about the construction of the temple or the setting up of the new images of the deity. Some inscriptions have royal orders on taxation and land revenue and resolutions of the village assemblies, judgments delivered against people guilty of theft, murder or other crimes. Inscriptions on temple walls served the purpose of public registrations, such as the records of sales, mortgages and other forms of the transfer. Then we have the Brindeshwara temple. The Chola built a number of temples. The gateway of the temple was called as the Gopuram. The main shrine was also known as the Garbhangira. Here the images of the gods and the goddess were kept. These images were made either of stone or of bronze. The mandapa or the audience hall was the place where people granted for prayers. It was built in the front of main shrine. The chief features of the Chola temple were the massive vimanas or the towers and the spacious courtyards. The best example of the Chola temple is the Brindeshwara, also known as the Rajeshwara temple, dedicated to the Lord Shiva. It is located at the Thanjavur and was built by the Chola king Rajaraja I. It was the best of the specimens and the Dravidian style of the architecture. Main structure of the temple was Great Vinama, or the temple which rises to the height of 190 feet. It was crowded by the massive dome consisting of a single block of stone 25 feet high and weighing about 80 tons. Then some of the political history of these Chola rulers were that the Vinayala established Chola rule in Tamil land and Thanjavur at his capital during the middle and the 9th century. After his death, his grandson Parantaka I became the king. He conquered Madurai and defeated the Pandyas and the rulers of the Lanka. By the end of the 11th century AD, the Chola power has reached at the height of its glory. Rajaraja I and his son Rajendra Chola was the two prominent rulers of the dynasty. Rajaraja I was a brilliant general and campaigned in many directions. He attacked as well as many parts of the Mysore. He defeated the Pandyas and Cheras. The Rajaraja I annexed part of the Deccan and over and Wingi. He did this in order to prove the strength of the Chola power. And the coast of the Kerala, which is Ceylon, Sri Lanka and the Maldives Islands, has become rich through the money that they came to them from the overseas trade. India sent textile species and precious stones as well as the Asian countries. To the Asian countries, the people who came to the West Asian to the trade in these goods were the Arab merchants who exchanged the goods and money. Foreigners threw wealth to India for their threat. Rajaraja I was aware of the importance of the controlling of sea. He decided to show the strength along the coast of the sea. So he took out a naval expedition and he attacked both Sri Lanka and Maldives Islands. He conquered the both half of Sri Lanka. He built the Rajeshwara temple of Lord Shiva and Thanjavur. On the walls of the temple and inscribed the main works of Rajaraja I under his rule. Then we have Rajendra Chola. Rajendra Chola succeeded his father Rajaraja I. He continued his father's policy. He invaded and annexed the whole island of Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka was not able to free herself from the Chola control for the other 50 years. Rajendra campaigns were daring. Once he armies marched up to the east coast of the India through Odisha and up to the Ganga River. Rajendra Chola himself led to the army up to the Godavari and thereafter there his general took charge of the army. Chola army defeated Mahipala king of the Bengal. To commemorate the victory, he adopted the title of Ganagikonda or Gangaikonda and built a new capital called Gangaikonda Cholapuram. And his most daring campaign was in the Southeast Asia. For centuries, India merchants have been trading with various parts of the East Asia in southern China, through the Straits of Malacca, which was held by the kingdom of the Sri Vijaya, modern day Indonesia. Then we have Chola administration. So the Chola system of the administration was highly organized and efficient. The king was the pivot of the administration, and the all authorities rested in his hands. We have central government, provincial government, self-local government, and some we have revenue. So the revenue of the Chola king was came from the taxes on the land and the produce of the land, and the tax on the trade part of the revenue was kept for the kings and the rest was used as the public works. Then we have Chola art. Chola rulers were great conquerors and efficient administrators, and they loved art and architecture. They built temples, as we learned, and canals, roads, cities and palaces. Most of the Chola temples were built at the Dharavindian style. Early Chola temples were simple structures. Later temples became bigger and more grand. This was a quite summary of this chapter. I hope you understood this chapter. This was a really easy chapter about the Cholas, and hope you like it. Make sure to subscribe and press the bell icon. Like my video and share with your friends if you find it useful. And tell me in the comments if you want me to explain any other topic. Till then, keep learning. Thank you. Bye.